Dear students, welcome back to the medical visualization lecture. That is the second part of the volume rendering lecture. We discussed requirements for volume rendering, typical data sets and data sizes, and looked a little bit more into texture-based approaches in the last lecture. Today I want to add image-based techniques that are used in practice quite often. Also some acceleration strategies should be discussed, namely the use of octrees in general in computer graphics and visualization. Hierarchical data structures like octrees or KD trees are often used in order to accelerate the search for points, for example. And I also want to describe some projection techniques that do not consider whether something is blocked by something else, obscured by something else, but analyze the intensity values that are encountered along a viewing ray, and for example compute the average or the maximum of this. These are quite simple visualization techniques, but they do not require to set any parameters, which is in practice quite essential, and therefore they are also used in practice. But let's start with image-based techniques. The overall name for them is ray casting. Yeah, we cast rays from the camera or the eye point in the scene and analyze along the sampling positions what we encounter, where we encounter strong gradients or regions where the opacity is quite high. And these are important parts that are perhaps analyzed in more detail. That means the resolution of the sampling positions is increased here. Yeah? Ray casting means that we only look for the direct light coming from a light source and do not compute indirect reflections, refractions, or other interactions of light with material. That would be done in ray tracing. Yeah, here we speak about ray casting, which means that we only look for the direct light. So for every sampling point, what do we have to do? We discussed this in the last video lecture. Namely, we can just round to the nearest voxel and take the intensity value that we have there, use it as input for the transfer function. But that leads to discontinuities, as we have seen. It would be better to resample there, to apply an interpolation, taking into around the surrounding voxels. Typically, this is done by a neighborhood where we consider 8 vertices. That means we have 3 linear interpolation, linear in x, y, and z direction. How this basics strategy could be improved. Something that was known as first hit ray casting is seen in this image here. Namely, we are interested in finding the first intersection of our ray with a surface and then compute quite precisely where the surface is located there in order to display it faithfully. Of course, it is also possible to consider multiple reflections, which would lead to ray tracing. However, that is computationally quite expensive. Yeah? And even today, with considerably faster hardware than 10, 15, 20 years before, that is still rarely done in practice. Yeah? With some exceptions that I will also discuss, not in this video lecture, but later in the next week when we also look in illumination effects. An essential variant of image-based ray casting is the use of early ray termination. That was in fact already suggested by Mark Levoy in 1988, so these are the very first papers that have been written on volume rendering at all. So if the accumulated opacity, you remember the volume rendering integral that we have seen in the last lecture, when this cumulative opacity reaches a certain value, 95% is really a good default value for this threshold, then we stop following this ray, taking into account that the remaining voxels have such a low influence on the resulting image that it is safe to ignore it. Not only that it is safe to ignore it, these very subtle contributions probably would not contribute to a clearer image, but instead be annoying. Adaptive refinement is a term also suggested by Mark Levoy already. That means to refine the ray computation in regions with a high or strong gradient, that is where gradient magnitude reaches high values and where we typically have material transitions. And refining here means that we increase the density of the sampling position. So perhaps they are one voxel distance away from each other, typically, but in regions with a high gradient that is increased to 0.4 voxels, for example. You remember the Nyquist theorem stating that if you achieve a reconstruction, a good reconstruction quality, if the distance between the sampling points is at least twice as high as the highest spatial frequency in the data. Adaptive ray sampling was a bit later introduced by Denskin and Pat Henrahan. Pat Henrahan was the second essential researcher dealing very early with volume rendering. So he suggested that the sampling rate is adapted in regions that are strongly transparent or in regions that are far away from the user, because there, in particular, if you apply perspective viewing, the influence on the resulting image is not so strong. Yeah, these are techniques and considerations, as some of you may know them from games, yeah, from rendering algorithms that are used in games. That means we compute those things really precisely that are important for visual perception, that are really noticed by viewers. And when things are projected, for example, to a very small area only, or otherwise, it can be assumed that it just does not matter for the perception, we simplify the computations to accelerate them. Hit point refinement means also a kind of adaptive refinement, namely that we increase the density of the sampling points if we are close to an ISO surface, that means to a material transition. And the binary search means that we subdivide the original interval between two sampling points recursively. We can do this several times until we achieve the desired accuracy of our visualization. Yeah, this is an image of this paper from Markus Hartwiger. You see a sampling grid here that takes into account that we have perspective projection. There are also volume renderings that use parallel projection, but here it's perspective projection. We have here a sampling point and here a sampling point as well, and that is the surface that actually should be shown. Yeah, and the system notices, understands that here is a viewing point that is outside of the ISO surface. Here is one that is inside. That means that there must be an intersection with the ISO surface in between these two points. So that is the situation when we should increase the accuracy. We do this indeed and look for this point in the middle of the two original sampling points and find out that this is still outside of the ISO surface. So the true intersection must be between this newly computed point and one of the original points. Yeah, this leads to this red point. And of course, we can do this several times and further increase the accuracy. The computational effort then, of course, increases as well. And at some point, further increasing the accuracy just does not help with respect to what the viewer really can perceive. Yeah. Yeah, so that is the basic strategy of ray casting. Yeah, We iterate over the pixels of our output image that we want to generate. So this leads to two for loops for all x and y coordinates of that image. We compute array. So with this, we iterate over the z values in our scene. And for each position and coordinate that we compute this way, we apply tree linear interpolation. This original ray casting was not very fast. Despite early ray termination and adaptive hit point refinement, texture-based rendering that we discussed in the last lecture was faster, for example. Yeah? That changed considerably in 2003 when Jens Krüger and Rüdiger Westermann introduced GPU-based ray casting. Yeah? That is indeed a quite essential paper. So they suggest to create textures that encode the start and end positions of the ray with the volume, and then rasterize a simple hull geometry, like a cuboid structure. Yeah? And then perform the integration, the volume rendering integration along the ray. Compared to texture-based rendering, this provides more flexibility. You can incorporate many things in the fragment shader, and also several acceleration strategies can be applied. Early ray termination is definitely a good idea with volume rendering, and it fits well to ray casting. Empty space skipping as well. Empty space skipping meaning if I have within the volume regions where the opacity is so low that these regions do not contribute, these should be skipped. Yeah, we want to go fast over them. This illustrates the idea of the two textures, an entry texture and an exit texture, where the x, y, and z coordinates are mapped to colors in RGB space in a way that is unambiguous. So one coordinate is really represented here by one color, and that is stored in the texture memory hardware. Yeah, and based on these colors, we can fetch back the positions of the entry and exit points for each ray. So that is a first step, yeah, to rasterize the simple hull geometry. And the second step, the second rendering pass, is the actual volume rendering, the ray casting process. Yeah. So here's an example where we applied this in our group. Sylvia Glaser and Christoph Kubisch did this work. They first created these textures for the overall image, and then refined it, taking into account the current transfer function specification, in such a way that they rasterized the visible portions of the anatomical model, and in this case, that was an anatomical model of the coronary arteries. Yeah, so what you do not see is the heart. Yeah, the heart would be here. And these vascular structures are on the surface of the heart, three large coronary vessels. And you see these bright parts here inside, which are, yeah, not ideal. So that means that is a patient data set, and the patient suffered from coronary artery disease, namely from plaques in the coronary arteries, which need treatment like a bypass surgery. Yeah. And that is the final rendering, which could be realized really fast, in particular because the number of, or the portion of visible voxels is quite low, and thus this idea of empty space skipping indeed accelerates the computation considerably. So I mentioned in the introductory statements that hierarchical data structures are often a good idea to improve and accelerate something. And that is also true for ray casting, as we will see. So we want to combine the advantages of object-based rendering techniques with those of image-based techniques. What are the advantages of object-based techniques? Well, object-based techniques iterate over the voxels of the volume first, instead of iterating over the pixels of the output image that should be generated. The iteration over the voxels in the volume has the advantage that there is a strong spatial coherence. That means I can fetch them from my 3D array in which I have stored the data. I can fetch a certain portion of it that is in the cache, and thus the high access speed to the cache is really employed here. And it may be also employed that the values often are quite similar because they are close to each other in space. Yeah, these are the advantages of object-based techniques. Image-based techniques primarily have the advantage that we can stop the computation along array when the cumulative opacity reaches a certain value. So we need a hierarchical structure that represents nodes with non-zero opacity. This may be modified with saying the opacity should be above a certain threshold, like 0.05, for example. An octree has many nodes. Yeah, that's clear. A graph-like structure. And raycasting is then performed for the individual octree nodes, and these results need to be combined to compose the final imaging. And this combination, of course, has to take into account the depth values, that means voxels that are closer to the viewer, height those that are further away. Yeah, if you think about this for a moment and whether it is a good idea or when it is a good idea, you may ask yourself what happens with this octree structure and its influence on the overall computation if the user changes the transfer function. Yeah, it depends a little bit on the specific application how frequently the user changes transfer functions. He may rely completely on predefined transfer functions and not change them at all. One variant. Another variant would be the user explores the data a bit more and uses techniques used in 2D imaging also to adjust the transfer function, namely to change on a mouse pad, for example, or with the mouse cursor X and Y coordinate. And this is mapped to changes of the width and center of the window that defines a linear transfer function. So he may change it quite frequently. If this is expected, then this octree raycasting is not a good idea, because whenever the transfer function changes, the hierarchical data structure need to be composed again, because that represents the regions where we have non-zero opacity. And when the transfer function changes, we have other regions with non-zero opacity. When the user, however, typically only rotates the data set, zooms in and out the data set, or adjusts a clipping plane that is moved through the data set, all these interactions do not change the non-zero opacity voxels, and thus the octree remains valid and can be used to accelerate further renderings. Yeah? So here we see two variants of such an octree. By the way, that is the realization of GPU-based raycasting in Mewis Lab that you will use in the exercises. You see on the one hand a quite, you have larger blocks, 64 times 64 times 64 voxels, and here they are smaller, better representing the geometry. So on the one hand, you can save a little time with the smaller nodes. On the other hand, you create more overhead, first in composing the data structure, but also in later composing the final image by taking all these sub-results into account. Yeah? So that's the idea of octree raycasting. Let's discuss another idea that is quite important, in particular in some applications: tagged volume rendering. Tagged means I have actually two kinds of input in this volume renderer. One is, like before, the medical volume data, a CT data set, for example. And the second type of input is segmentation information, typically in the same resolution. So we have the same number of voxels, but instead of intensity values, we know which object is visible at that at that portion in the data. What is represented here? Is this a voxel of a vascular structure, a muscle, a skeletal structure, or so on? Yeah. So if we have this information available, we can try to generate a kind of volume rendering that selectively emphasizes certain objects. Yeah, that means voxels that have a particular volume ID representing one object. Or we could also try in general to increase the boundaries between such objects. Yeah. Different situations may occur if I have a small neighborhood in which I look for boundaries. I may have zero object that is segmented. Maybe that's just background, or one object, or even more objects. Yeah. The simplest case is when we have either zero or one object. If we have more objects, then we have to precisely determine the boundaries. Yeah, and that is meant with high quality volume rendering. That was introduced by Ulf Tiede and Karl-Heinz Höhne, that is the Voxelman group in Hamburg. This group that did really pioneering work on medical visualization, for example, in anatomy education. And they tried their very best in order to provide high quality rendered images to support learning. The idea of text volume rendering can be brought even further, namely to combine different rendering styles in a flexible manner. And that was the major contribution of Helwig Hauser and Markus Hartwiger at the BIAWIS in Vienna approximately 20 years before. So they could combine rendering styles like direct volume rendering, maximum intensity projection, which we will discuss in 20 minutes or so, non-photorealistic rendering styles like boundary enhancement. That all was possible with two-level volume rendering. Yeah, where actually in the first rendering pass, the individual rendering styles are applied to different subsets, and in the second pass, these are combined to create a final image. But back to the original paper from Ulf Tiede, and that could remind you to this idea of first hit point ray casting, where the sampling points are refined when we are close to an isosurface. Yeah? So the same happens here. This is the original distance of the sampling points. Then it turns out we are in one object here. Here is another object. So we have to more precisely determine what happens here to compute as precise as possible ISO values. Yeah? So it's again such an iterative bisection guided by an error term that tells you when it's no longer necessary to bisect anymore to compute more precise sampling points. And that was particularly used in order to define the front faces as precisely as possible and to use this as input for shading. Yeah? If this would not represent it so faithfully, then specular highlights, for example, would emphasize discontinuities on the surface that are not the true discontinuities. Anatomical surfaces typically are round and smooth, but represent the limited spatial resolution of the data. So, and this bisection, of course, is more accurate than just a linear interpolation of the values in between, yeah, because that gives you further values and really enable a better precision. Here we see a comparison from this original paper from Tiede and colleagues showing in 2D how this would look like, and here you see how this was applied in real 3D rendering, where several neuroanatomical structures, gyri and sulci in the brain, have been segmented and can now be faithfully shown. Yeah, here we see a comparison between conventional shading and high quality shading based on this high quality rendering process that I have introduced before. And yeah, I think it becomes quite obvious that here the anatomical surfaces, again these gyri and sulci in the brain, look much more realistic than here. And remember that this is not only aesthetically not as convenient as the rendering that you see here. These further edges here are distracting. Yeah, so what needs to be considered? We have to consider these tech ideas for the different structures. Imagine that we have 8 bits, so that would make it possible to represent up to 256 different structures. Yeah, it's necessary to be aware of the fact that the tech ID cannot be interpolated. Yeah, that makes no sense. There is no intermediate value between them. Yeah, so a proper trilinear interpolation is necessary. Yeah? You see another close up here, where even with proper interpolation, we still have artifacts and aliasing problems, but they are more severe if interpolation is applied to the tag IDs, where it should really not happen. This idea of tagged volume rendering was extended in several ways, not surprisingly, particularly by the group in Vienna where it was invented. So here is Stefan Bruckner's work that employed a kind of per object shading with so-called lid spheres, which you see here. So the user has not to adjust many parameters of the lighting specification. He can just select one of these predefined configurations to come up with quite expressive volume renderings. Yeah, so that's a further extension of tagged volume rendering. Yeah, with this I want to quit with tagged volume rendering and want to present now projection methods. Yeah, projection methods have in common that they are image-based. Yeah, you may remember still the raycasting process. So again, we iterate over the pixels of the final image that we want to generate. And now we apply a certain function to all the values that we encounter along our sampling points. Yeah? A transfer function may be specified to the output here as well, but that is optional. It's not necessary. So at a radiological workstation, you can just enable, for example, the maximum intensity projection without the necessity to further specify some parameters. Maximum intensity projection would mean that along the viewing ray you search for the maximum that is encountered and that is mapped to a gray value. Yeah? Linearly, the lowest values are mapped to black, the highest values to white, and anything in between to intermediate values. A disadvantage is that the depth perception is considerably worse compared to direct volume rendering. Because if you imagine this, whether the maximum occurs quite close to the viewer or far away has no influence on the resulting gray value. If you would rotate the whole volume by 180 degrees, yeah, you would have encountered the same positions along each viewing ray, just in opposite order. The maximum intensity projection would be the same. The assumption with maximum intensity projection is that those structures that have high intensity values are particularly interesting. That is often the case in angiographic data when a contrast agent is used to increase the intensity values of the vascular structures. So they indeed may be the brightest structures, but they are not in all anatomical regions. Bones, for example, also have quite high values and then might occlude the vessels that should be shown with this technique. Yeah, so there is the maximum intensity projection. In principle, in a similar way, you could also compute a minimum intensity projection, but that is in practice not that useful. An average projection would more or less simulate an X-ray image. Yeah, if you apply an average projection to CT data, then you can create an image that looks quite similar to an X-ray image, and therefore that is sometimes realized in anatomy education systems that should make learners aware with how certain structures would look like in X-ray imaging. The closest vessel projection, which we will see in a minute, is a refinement of the maximum intensity projection in such a way that not the global maximum is used and projected in image space, but instead the first local maximum that is above a certain threshold. And that has the advantage: if there is a smaller vascular structure in front of a larger vascular structure, with closest vessel projection, the smaller structure, the closest vessel, will be displayed. Whereas with the maximum intensity projection, typically the larger vessel has higher values and it is displayed even if another vascular structure is in front of it. Yeah. So, maximum intensity projection takes the maximum value along a viewing ray and is order independent. Originally, that was invented for nuclear medicine data, PET data and SPECT data, where the assumption was that regions where the activity is highest, these are the regions that are most interesting. Only later it has been used, even extensively used, for the visualization of vascular structures, sometimes also for searching lung nodules in CT data, for example. Yeah? You see that I have linked some information here, videos, for example, that show how maximum intensity projection is used in a workstation, for example, from Aqua Healthcare. Yeah? So these are the schemes, the maximum intensity projection scheme and the closest vessel projection scheme. Yeah, I start here. The lines here illustrate the viewing rays that we consider. Yeah, and we go here all the way until the very end. Yeah, with maximum intensity projection, there is nothing like early ray termination because we do not know when the maximum actually occurs. It may occur quite late in the traversal of the viewing ray. Yeah. So dark here means that we have high intensity. So these regions are shown that have the highest intensities. The first ray here completely misses our object and goes in the background. Here we have this first layer of our spherical structure that leads to a maximum. Here it is the second layer. Here also, then we really go in the black structure, the most inner spherical structure, where we have the highest values. Yeah, here we encounter this maximum even earlier. Yeah. So, and with the closest vessel projection, we often stop earlier. Yeah, you see that these arrows do not go to the very end, because as soon as we encounter a sampling point that is above our threshold value, we only look whether the values are still increasing so that we reach the point where we have a local maximum, and then we can stop the ray termination. So the closest vessel projection is faster. Yeah. So this compares once more what happens here. That is our threshold level. We have our viewing ray. We encounter a first local maximum, but that's below the threshold. We have a minimum here. We have increasing values. Here we increase, we are beyond the threshold value for the first time. So the algorithm goes in a different mode, knowing that it is now beyond the threshold value, looking for further increases. This is reached here. That means the next one is smaller. So this is the local maximum, and that is projected. Yeah. Whereas with the maximum intensity projection, we would go all the way and notice that there is an even higher point, indeed the global maximum, and that would be shown. Yeah. So here are maximum intensity projections of MR angiography data. So indeed a contrast agent was used here. You certainly see and recognize that these are vascular structures in the brain, yeah, the cerebral arteries, shown from two different viewing directions. The spatial impression is not very well if you look at these static images. However, one must be fair in assessing the quality of maximum intensity projection. The user would typically not look at such static images, but either he would interactively explore them, and that means in particular to rotate them, or the system automatically generates rotations, in particular rotations that horizontally go one time around our model. So, and if you see these visualizations in an animated movement, then you can recognize the spatial resolutions better, because then you have motion parallax as an additional depth cue. Yeah. So that's a comparison of maximum intensity projection and the direct volume rendering as we have discussed it before. Yeah, here is such an example where you clearly see a small vascular structure in front of another one, whereas here everything is bright, so maybe the small vascular structure has basically the same values as the large one, yeah, but you cannot discriminate the individual vessels anymore. Yeah. But this requires more computation and also more specification of input parameters. Some advanced concepts: if indeed skeletal structures are disturbing the interpretation of CT angiography data with maximum intensity projection, then it is a good idea to segment the bones. Typically, we segment structures because we want to emphasize them. Here, it's quite different. We segment the bones to get rid of them. Yeah, they should no longer disturb our visualization. And such bone removal functions are indeed part of every radiology workstation. Maximum intensity projection can also be applied to a certain partial volume, yeah, not to the whole structure, like intact volume rendering. Yeah, that's also possible. Yeah, we see examples left, maximum intensity projection, quite old publication, direct volume rendering, and here a closest vessel projection where you see more of the smaller vascular structures. So it seems that the closest vessel projection is somehow better than the maximum intensity projection. Yeah, here is another example from Karel Zuiderfeld, the guy who invented CVP. Yeah, here you see, for example, one small vascular structure in front of a larger structure, whereas here you only see the large structure and cannot recognize that this vessel here is actually in front of the large vessel. So there must be also a disadvantage of the closest vessel projection. Yeah, it leads to better images and it is faster because we can stop the ray traversal in many cases earlier. But the question is, which threshold should we use? That is not so obvious. So here the user has to specify a parameter quite carefully in order to come up with these better closest vessel projections. As a default value, Zuiderfeld suggests the following. The threshold value should be a certain percentage of the maximum value that occurs in the whole data set. So imagine that 1,500 Hounsfield values is the maximum in your data set, then 1,000 or 1,100 could be a good threshold value. Yeah? So it's really important to support the user here in specifying this value, otherwise that can be a bit cumbersome and tedious. Maybe before we go on, a question for you to think about a little bit. I said several times that the smaller vascular structure is often occluded in maximum intensity images by a larger one that has brighter values. Yeah, and here is clearly such an example. This is darker, meaning it has lower values, but it is in front of this one, and here it would not be seen. Why is this the case? Shouldn't vascular structures everywhere have the same intensity value? Yeah, that's the question. It is indeed true that smaller vascular structures typically have lower values. And the reason is the partial volume effect, the limited spatial resolution. For a larger vascular structure, you have many voxels in every cross section that you could make, a couple of voxels that are completely inside the vascular structure and as a consequence filled with contrast agent. That makes them bright. Whereas a smaller vascular structure has a high fraction, perhaps even a 100% fraction of Boundary voxels that belong partially to the vascular structure and are partially filled with contrast agent, but not completely. Yeah. So the intensity value that arises is an average of the contrast agent intensity and surrounding tissue. And surrounding tissue has lower values, and that makes it darker. Stefan Bruckner, a name that I mentioned already before, is a smart guy. He carefully thought about normal volume rendering, maximum intensity projections, and advantages and disadvantages, and that led him to suggest another projection method that is somewhere in between. So actually with this technique, the so-called maximum intensity difference accumulation, abbreviated as MIDA, there is a continuum where the maximum intensity projection is on the one end and the classical direct volume rendering is on the other hand. Yeah, we re-implemented this technique in our work as well, and you see some results that occur when we apply this technique with different values for this gamma parameter that defines actually how strongly we use this MIDA process. Yeah. That is the classical direct volume rendering that we get when we choose the lowest possible value, namely minus one. And that is the maximum intensity projection that results if we choose this as one. So, but the goal was, of course, not to emulate in another process direct volume rendering and maximum intensity projection, but instead to generate something in between. And this is motivated by the idea that typically the users and viewers of volume rendered images are particularly interested in intensity differences and with this in material transitions. So with this MIDA approach, intensity differences are emphasized. Yeah. So even if I'm along my viewing ray already a bit further in the volume, and even if with classical volume rendering I would have already a quite large accumulated opacity, I should see this strong intensity difference that may occur further away from the viewer. Yeah, that was the idea. And yeah, to show this graphically in a sketch that is from Stefan's paper, here you see three times the same intensity profile that arises when I follow a ray in the scene. Yeah, I have certain local maxima. It's a bit noisy, I would say. Then here is a quite high value followed by considerably lower values, and again two peaks here where one of them represents the global maximum. So these are the data values, and in red you see the accumulated opacity. Yeah, and with a certain transfer function, the accumulated opacity is such that already here, even with quite low values, a lot of opacity is used. And from this point on, which is quite early, the maximum, the accumulated opacity reaches its maximum. So with early ray termination, we may forget about everything that comes here. Yeah. Maximum intensity difference accumulation, however, starts similarly, but reduces the opacity then in order to be able to increase material transitions, intensity changes, like this change here is illustrated again with increasing opacity values, and also these here. At some point later, there is no more opacity available to emphasize the latest points here along this viewing grain. Maximum intensity projection has no accumulated opacity, so therefore here is no red line, just the blue line, and the blue line indicates the value that is actually shown at the end. We traverse the ray, look for maxima here. After this local maximum, this stays constant because we have no further value. Then it goes up again, and here we finally have the maximum value. Yeah? So that is a monotonically increasing line. Yeah. So this is the difference between MIDA, MIP, and direct volume rendering. Another comparison, here's a direct volume rendering. Admittedly, that is not the best possible transfer function to show anything from this data, but that might easily happen. Yeah. Here is MIDA as an intermediate, showing skeletal structures, vascular structures, and some soft tissue structures quite well. And here's a maximum intensity projection that shows primarily skeletal structures and vascular structures. Sometimes with these darker gray values, you see also some other structures. I think these are the kidneys here on the left and on the right that have the chance that at some points there is no vascular structure or skeletal structure in front. Yeah. So let me come back to this idea of a hybrid rendering. We discussed already briefly the idea of two-level volume rendering, which enables such hybrid renderings. That means combinations of different rendering style in one rendering. And this is particularly useful in the situation when we have tagged data, that means we have segmented objects. But also if we want to show simultaneously volume data with other graphical elements like instruments, scalpels, needles that should be used for a certain intervention, for example. Yeah. Also, vascular structures may be realized and rendered with surface rendering, maybe based on some model assumptions that lead to a quite smooth and high quality rendering, and that should be integrated with the anatomical context provided by a direct volume rendering of the original data. So why this is not so easy, this hybrid rendering? Well, if I have different rendering styles like boundary enhancement, surface rendering, and volume rendering, I still have to make sure that the realized final image correctly reflects the depth relations. Yeah, that means I may have surfaces that hide part of the volume rendered data, or on opposite, I may have parts of the volume data rendered to non-opaque voxels that hide part of the surface structures. And if I want to integrate even more rendering style, things get even more complex. Some volume rendering systems, in particular early volume rendering systems, restricted hybrid volume rendering to the situation when the surfaces are definitely opaque and not semi-transparent. So that means we have semi-transparent portions in the volume rendered part of the image, but we have no semi-transparency in the surfaces. If this is the case, we can render the surfaces with the conventional Z-buffer approach and then use this rendering result as input and combine it for a volume rendering, yeah, where the volume data are shown in front of the surfaces. So when volume rendering is sufficiently transparent, you see the surface structures. Yeah, but that does not work with semi-transparent surfaces. There is also one approach of hybrid volume rendering that integrates surface rendering directly in direct volume rendering. That means there is only one rendering path that combines them. That is very complex. The logic there is very complex. For example, for ray casting, it means that whenever you compute the portions between two sampling points in volume rendering, you have to look in your polygonal mesh representing your surface whether there is a triangle in between, and if so, how to combine the information from this part of the volume data with a triangle or even several triangles from the surface data. Another strategy could be to transform the data in such a way that you have one unified representation. And in this case, you would voxelize the surface data. Yeah. So instead of a triangular mesh, you then have a set of voxels representing this surface, for example, the virtual scalpel or a needle. So that's always possible, of course, and in fact, you can then apply one rendering step where you combine the information of the intensity values from the volume data as well as which voxel belongs to a certain surface. But to voxelize something, voxelization is a discretization process that has a certain resolution and with it a certain accuracy. Yeah? So if something was perfectly circular before, you cannot faithfully represent this in a voxelized way. You come close to it if you use really a large amount of voxels. Yeah? So that is the disadvantage of the voxelization structure. And then there is also a fourth approach that works together with texture-based volume rendering, where the volume is split into slices of texture triangles, and that is combined with the triangles from the surface mesh in a sorting process that considers the depth, yeah, a depth sorting process. So here's work from our group. We combined silhouette rendering, surface rendering, and volume rendering. Yeah? So here you see the set buffer where all the structures in this data set, that is an abdominal CT data set, yeah, so this region with the liver, the kidneys, the gallbladder, and so on, that is represented here. Yeah. So for silhouette rendering, we also computed all boundary lines, yeah, everything that is at the boundary of an object. Yeah. This is the surface shading, so the user decided that the liver, the tumor in the liver, the vascular trees in the liver should be realized as surface rendering. So with this information available, we reduce this set of lines considerably to the visible lines that you see here. Yeah? And that can finally be combined. Yeah? Here you see surface rendering and silhouette rendering combined with correct depth relations. So these ribs here are indeed in front of the liver, whereas here some other parts of the ribs that are more on the back are hidden by the surface representation. By the way, do you know what a silhouette is or why a silhouette is called a silhouette? Yeah, these kinds of drawings where objects are represented by silhouettes goes back to Etienne de Silhouette, that was a French politician, not primarily an artist, a politician, a minister even. And if he was in meetings that took very long and he considered as boring, he started to draw silhouette images. Yeah, that's why these structures are called silhouettes. Here you see another combination where we have surface rendering, volume rendering, and even further imposed to emphasize the boundaries, silhouette rendering. Yeah? So that was at that time a quite quite useful contribution, because for the first time silhouette, surface, and volume rendered images could be combined in one image with correct depth sorting. Yeah. Back to the two-level volume rendering process that I have only briefly introduced, but without specific examples to appreciate this. Two-level volume rendering is a concept for integrating rendering techniques, and that was even before the work carried out in our work. So one can say that we have extended the two-level rendering process. Also, they require that the relevant anatomy is segmented before, so a situation where we can apply tagged volume rendering. The goal was to really generate expressive visualizations, fine-tuned for specific tasks the user may have. For example, to understand as good as possible infiltrations of a tumor in surrounding tissue. And not only that, expressive renderings should be provided, but also efficient implementation should be ensured, because otherwise that takes just too long. Yeah, the graphics hardware needs to be used whenever you try to generate something that has a high performance. Here the fragment shader is particularly important, and also the stencil buffer, which allows you to mask part of an image, part of volume data that should not be taken into account for a particular rendering pass. Yeah, boundary enhancement, what does this actually mean? Here the dot product of the gradient, yeah, this vector, and the viewing vector is computed and assessed, and yeah, if these are orthogonal to each other, then we have a point that belongs to the boundary of an object. Yeah, that is the formula that specifies it. Yeah, if they are orthogonal to each other, this would be a 1. So then we get a very low value. Of course, we should not test whether something is precisely 0. Instead, we test whether the magnitude is smaller than a certain threshold value, an epsilon value that is just a very small number. Yeah, here we see a conceptual sketch of two-level volume rendering. The viewpoint array is computed. We have different pre-segmented objects. And yeah, for example, this object should be shown with maximum intensity projection. And this occurs here and here and here as well. So it has 3 separate segments. Then there is this object rendered in green. That should be shown with a non-photorealistic rendering style, like boundary enhancement. And here is direct volume rendering for the yellow object. Yeah. So the rendering mode may even change several times, and whenever it changes, a different fragment shader program is enabled. Yeah. 2D and 1D transfer functions can be used for this purpose. We discuss in a later lecture 2D transfer functions. Yeah, here you see indeed some examples. It's a quite famous data set because it was used very often, a high resolution data set of the human hand, pre-segmented so that the vascular structures, the bone, the skin are realized as separate objects. Yeah. On the left, you see just shaded image, so everything is shaded with direct volume rendering. In the middle, the skin is shown with boundary enhancement, yeah, with the NPR contours, and that is combined with a MIP rendering of the vascular structures, and the bones are shown with direct volume rendering. The right images combines maximum intensity projection, toon shading, another non-photorealistic rendering, and shaded isosurfaces. Yeah, I want to summarize volume rendering as we have discussed it so far. I made a number of comments on performance, which I want to summarize a bit more. The performance of a volume renderer depends on the image resolution, yeah, because that just determines how many rays you have to compute. On the sampling rate in the z direction, because these two together, the image resolution and the sampling rate in z direction, determine how many sampling points you have. Then it also depends, of course, on what you are actually doing at each sampling point, namely whether you apply just nearest neighbor interpolation or a tree linear interpolation, or perhaps even a tree cubic interpolation in a larger region that would involve 64 voxels for every sampling point. That's quite expensive. Yeah. It depends also on some acceleration strategies like early ray tracing, early ray termination. And yeah, several trade-offs are possible to achieve. On the one hand, a good quality, and on the other hand, a high performance. So for example, you can reduce the resolution of volume rendering, resolution in the sense of sampling rate and image resolution, if the user is just rotating an object or moving a clipping plane or zooming in and out to ensure that the frame rate is high enough. And whenever the user stops, yeah, he releases the mouse button, for example, then you may compute the full resolution image. Yeah, that is a strategy that's also realized in Mevis Lab. You can adjust the resolutions that are used there. That is quite useful. Yeah. Second part of the summary, we discussed direct volume rendering only of regular data sets. Yeah, that makes sense. Because in medicine with CT, MRI, but also with the nuclear medicine methods, we have tomographic images with equidistant planes and a constant resolution in the planes and also a constant slice distance. We discussed as a variant tagged volume rendering, realized with different ways like hybrid volume rendering. That is an essential extension of the original volume rendering strategies. We looked a bit more in image-based procedures like ray casting and their GPU acceleration, and it became clear that the graphics hardware should be exploited to come up with efficient volume rendering systems. Often that is not so easy. GPU-based ray casting is really based on a number of tricks. Yeah, the graphics hardware was not invented for supporting volume rendering, but it can be exploited for this purpose as well. We discussed some projection methods, in particular maximum intensity projection, closest vessel projection, and MIDA. And when we compared them, we looked at the quality of the images that result, but also again on the performance. I prepared a number of links for you that may explain some things in more detail that I have done. So in order not to reinvent the wheel, I have not tried to repeat everything that Hanwei Shen or Bob Laramie or Klaus Engel have described, but I would encourage you to look at these videos. I want to briefly comment on the references that I have used for this lecture. Actually, it's not very large number of publications that I have used. A few of them I want to emphasize a bit. Drabin, Carpenter, and Henrachan wrote a SIGGRAPH paper in 1988 where they introduced volume rendering. So that is, of course, a landmark paper, a pioneering paper. Klaus Engel, by the way, that's not a university scientist, but the leading volume rendering developer at Siemens Healthcare, and colleagues Markus Hartwiger, Joe Niss, Christoph Restalama, and Daniel Weiskopf wrote a whole book on real-time volume graphics. And although this is meantime 14 years old, I still consider this a quite useful reference. Two-level volume rendering was not introduced, but described quite carefully by Hartwiger and Hauser. You see there is an older reference also to two-level volume rendering. So this group, Hartwiger and Hauser, introduced this. GPU-based ray casting is from Krüger and Westermann, so that is really important. And with respect to transfer functions, a topic that we will discuss later a bit more in detail, I would emphasize and recommend a survey paper, a state-of-the-art report from Patrick Jung and colleagues. And what I also want to emphasize a little bit, because it's an important, frequently cited paper from the same group, by the way, it's about uncertainty visualization in medical volume rendering using probabilistic animation. You remember these images where I tried to show that whether something is a stenosis or not depends so subtly on transfer function parameters. That is described in this paper from Klaas Lundström and colleagues. Yeah, with this, I'm at the end and I want to thank you.